This evening on The Rock Newman Show, just days before the last live broadcast of NewsOne Now with Roland Martin, the television host shares his thoughts on the state of black media, the current state of politics, and his plans for the future. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. After almost 5 years, Roland Martin will sign off as host and managing editor of the daily news program NewsOne Now. The only national news program geared towards African Americans will air its last live broadcast December 21st. Take a look at Roland in action on NewsOne Now.
Easily. Two of the most vocal advocates for criminal justice reform in the U.S. Senate are working across the aisle on a major bill. Senator Paul Rand of Kentucky, Senator Kamala Harris of California, co-authored the Pretrial Integrity and Safety Act. It encourages states to do away with the standard monetary bail process, as system acts as a disadvantage for lower-income citizens and people of color that have to remain in jail simply because they can't afford bail. Making her first appearance on NewsOne Now TVOne as a senator is Kamala Harris. How you doing?
Very well, Mr.
Glad to finally get you here.
I am so happy to see you this
morning. Before we talk about this here, healthcare, seriously? We can't have a hearing? We can't even have anything in public? Can we show it on TV?
Welcome, good brother, and I am so happy to have you here tonight.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Man, you are on a whirlwind. Last night, less than 24 hours ago, you set social media on fire with your analysis of the race in Alabama. In particular, you went hard about the value of black folks having political power,
right,
and how to use it. Prior to responding, I actually want to put up another clip of you talking about something similar. Let's take a look.
Three of the sisters who have co-organized this know the story because they were part of it. We were at the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March. I was interviewing Tamika, Carmen, and Lyndon. And when we finished with the interview, we put the mics away, and I said, you're going to get a series of phone calls for my television show and radio show. I said, and the reason for that is y'all have been doing the work while other folks have been talking. And I say to the three of them, no matter what platform that I have, I will put you on those platforms or whatever it is that you are organizing. And so what they've been doing with the New York Justice League, with the Women's March as well. And I say that because it doesn't matter if you are a man, you have to use your platforms for good. So they know that. So whenever Linda or Tamika or Carmen call, I said, no problem, we do it, whether it's Tom Joe on a morning show or TV One. And that matters because you do not change a system if you are unwilling to stand with others to do so. And so that's the case. And they're always, and Michaela, you know, they're always haters. And I say to any of the haters, if you're not putting in the work, all you're doing is talking and tweeting. If you put in the work, then you don't have time to always talk and tweet. So some folk may want to stop hating and put the work in. I'm sorry, let me preach that thing. Go ahead, Michaela.
So last night in Alabama, folks put the work in and beat Judge Rory Moore,
yep,
Steve Bannon, and Donald Trump. Please share with us part of what your analysis was last night about the value and importance of the black vote.
Well, it's very simple. First of all, the Alabama, the black belt, is the cradle of black voting. When you go back to Selma, when you talk about Montgomery, Birmingham, Mobile, and what folks did, I mean, the Black Panther Party actually originated in Lowndes County. It was a political party. Stokely Carmichael and others were sitting here mobilizing African Americans. And then, of course, that thing went to the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party as well. And so black folks showed America what their power is like. Well, what has happened is, in many cases, we've said, well, there's so many other white voters, we really can't have an impact. But the bottom line is, when we vote our numbers, then we can change an election. And so what happened in Alabama is simple. President Barack Obama got 29% of the total electorate turnout in Alabama in 2008, 29% was black. 2012 was 28%. Last night, it was 30%. And so, now sure, people say, well, you get a decrease in terms of white turnout because of Roy Moore. But the bottom line is that increase in black turnout gave Doug Jones the margin of victory. Now, take that thing further. 800,000 black folks unregistered but eligible in Georgia. 2.1 million Hispanics in Texas, eligible but unregistered. And so versus sitting here worrying about what somebody else is doing, if we are voting our numbers, then we don't have a close election in Atlanta for the mayor's race. Keisha Lance Bottoms doesn't win by less than 800 votes. You don't have a situation where the sister doesn't win in St. Louis, even when you have four other black male candidates. You can go across the country if we vote our numbers, but you can't have black political power when you have 25% turnout in Birmingham, when you have less than 25% in Atlanta, 24% in St. Louis, when you have barely 20% in Detroit. We literally have power that's sitting here that's untapped, unused, and then folks complaining that nothing is getting done. That's what we saw in Alabama, and black women drove that. 98% turned out, 92% for black men. Remember, in 2016, also in 2012, was a 9-point gap. 94% of black women went for Trump. 85% of black men went for Trump. 94% of black women went for Obama in 2012. 85% went for Obama as well, so it was a 9-point gap there. Sisters are the most powerful constituency in the Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. Rock, I was at a meeting in, this was in 16. At the RNC, Ryan's Priebus is sitting right there, two seats over from me. A sister in the meeting says, no group hates us more than black women. There is nothing we can do to attract black women.
That's another black woman.
A black Republican in the presence of Ryan's Priebus and three of his top executives. Mm-hmm. So if you're Democrats, you need to stop trying to chase white conservative women. That's what Hillary messed up. Cornell Belcher was on NewsOne Now in March of 16 saying, will y'all stop spending money trying to chase these mythical white conservative women? They are not going to vote for you. Put that money to turn out more black women. Black women will bring out black men. Black women will bring out their black students. They'll bring out their children, their nieces and nephews. That's how you win. But too many of us are letting our power go untapped.
And the Democratic Party needs to be still called to task for still taking for granted those voters that you're talking about.
Yeah, I mean it's very basic. Republicans don't take white conservative evangelicals for granted. But Democrats go, oh, well, they'll turn out. Yeah. No, you've got to put the resources there. You've got to have your yard signs. You've got to have your phone banks. You've got to have your touches. What has happened is, and this is the mistake they make, and this is where black people get upset with me, but this is where Obama made the mistake. Black folks turned out for Obama because who he was. The problem is that decimated the black infrastructure in the Democratic National Committee. Decimated. What Reverend Jackson, what Ron Brown, Dr. Ron Walters, what they put in place after Reverend Jackson's win in 1988, that was decimated because Obama said, I didn't need that. Didn't need it.
Right.
So here's the problem. The problem is, oh, we can just roll out an Obama robocall or a couple of ads. No, you still have to have infrastructure. Infrastructure means people on the ground. Stop expecting black folks to volunteer for campaigns and pay folks to get out the vote. That means that if you're trying to take a state, you got to take cities. Take cities, you got to take neighborhoods. Neighborhoods, blocks, blocks, streets, streets, houses, precinct captains. That's how you win. It's Doug Jones won because of old school politicking. That's how he won. Well, they said, who are the registered voters in his county? Call everyone. There was a guy who tweeted, talked to the NAACP in Mobile. They called every single person, unlike 2016. They touched folks. They hit the churches, the social organizations. They hit every fraternity and sorority. They use black infrastructure. That's how, and black folks also funded it because they were late with the money. Black folks pooled their resources. There were a group of black women raised $250,000, put 800 volunteers out there. And so what it says to us, we can't wait for a candidate or a party because we're still voting our interest. Last night wasn't, we love Doug Jones. Last night was, black folks said, we can't stand Roy Moore, can't stand Trump, and we vote our interest. And so we can't wait for somebody else to mobilize us. That's why when Bob Johnson came on NewsOne Now after Trump got elected, and he said, well, black folks, you know, we got to be focused. I said, okay, but folks like you also got to help us fund it. And so I said, let's have that meeting where we talk about 2018, 2020. And I said, call the meeting. He said, well, he said, I'll be happy to call it. He said, you call it with me. I said, fine, when you want to do it. Now I'm still waiting. For Bob's people to get
tonight,
back with
tonight, you're still waiting.
But I made it clear to them. I said, okay, I've called. When are we having this meeting? Because I'm focused on next year. I'm not focused on Democrats. I'm focused on black interest. That's a difference.
Okay, now that leads me right to a comment. When I looked at your video this morning, you were approaching 400,000 views and—
Oh, we're past half a million.
Thousands and thousands of comments. And I saw a comment, and a woman said, I'm white, and I didn't vote for Roy Moore. I voted for Doug Jones. But please don't divide us, she said. Please don't divide us. It's to hear her ears and many like her. You talking black empowerment and black self-interest sounded like division. And to her, you would say what?
I would tell her, white folks talk to white folks. White conservative evangelicals talk to white folks. What she doesn't understand is, if I did not say what I said last night in the last month, now again, I'm not taking credit, but what I'm saying is, if I did not say what I said last night over the last 2 months, last night don't happen. If I don't put Doug Jones on my Tom Joyner Morning Show segment three times, talking right to black people, asking him specific black questions, he was being general. Other than I prosecuted the Klansman who killed the four little girls, 16th Street Baptist Church, he was talking general. No. I needed him talking about HBCUs, talking about black economic development, talking about criminal justice reform. And so having that, if I'm not charging black folks up, if I'm not putting on Dawana Patterson, if I'm not putting on these young black folks, she said it. She said, Roland, you put us on, that fired up the black kids on HBCUs. They were competing who can turn more people out. If I'm not talking black on black platforms, we're not engaging in turning out black people. So white folks have always talked to each other. See, that's the deal. They want us to do, no, can you include everybody? No, I can't. Because I need white women like her to go talk to white women to say, when y'all gonna wake the hell up? Last night, Roy Moore got a majority of white women in Alabama. See, so the problem is in America, you can talk to angry white men. Everybody was doing stories after Trump won. We need to go talk to and listen to the white working class in Michigan, in Wisconsin, in Pennsylvania, and in Ohio. they're feeling all of that pain. I say, well, damn it, we feeling the same pain in Ohio, but in Cleveland and not rural Ohio. We feeling the same pain in Pennsylvania, but in Philadelphia. We're feeling the same pain in Michigan, in Detroit. We're feeling the same pain in Wisconsin, in Milwaukee. But see, America has always loved when white folks are talking to each other. But when you black, oh, no, you can't do that. See, I remind them that America was built for white landowners, was not built for us. So for 398 years, we've been trying to force America to talk to us. See, white Democrats don't want me demanding accountability when it comes to dollars. They don't want, well, no, why can't we just all get along? They don't want me saying, where are the black pollsters? Where are the black political consultants, the black campaign managers, the high-ranking black staffers? Where are the black media companies doing radio ads and television ads? Where are the black folks who run Get Out the Vote campaigns? You can't tell me that only white folks know how to do television ads and radio ads. They only ones who know how to do grassroots mobilization. Mm-hmm. No. How is it that under President Barack Obama, the Democrats spent more than $500 million, according to the Power PAC study, and only 1.7% went to firms that had at least a black partner? I didn't say black control firms. 1.7%. How can Democrats practice income inequality when it comes to funding our companies? No, they have wanted black folks to be political sharecroppers. Mm-hmm. They have wanted us to till the land, to sit here and work the land, but not get paid for it. And what I'm saying is, we've got black expertise, we've got black knowledge, and I'm going to talk to black folks. I'm not apologizing for it.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to talk.
That's what I would tell her.
Yeah, okay. I hear you. So that really brings me to a point of the state of black media, and it has much to do recently with the announcement that your NewsOne show is ending. But just prior to that, with all that you just said, it seems to me that that is capsulized that still in 2017, people do not understand that pro-black does not mean anti-white.
Right.
Just continues in a very fundamental way.
Right.
That there seems to be a sense of being threatened.
When absolutely.
With all that you just said, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out. With what you just said, that sounded very threatening to a good amount of white folks.
Because they don't like it when we are talking freedom. They've never liked it. That's why there's a visceral reaction among white folks to Colin Kaepernick and NFL players protesting. Because they're saying, how dare you? They're saying, well, wait a minute, if you don't have anything to worry about. Yeah. You're an NFL player. Yet they said nothing when San Diego Chargers moved from San Diego to L.A. And those brothers start talking about the racial discrimination they faced when trying to going and buying multi-million-dollar houses. See, they won't discuss that. They won't talk about the indignities that African-Americans face who are millionaires. And people say, that's your Rolls Royce? But yeah. Robert Smith, brother, worth $2.4 billion, has talked about when he gets pulled over by cops driving on his way to the airport where his private jet is waiting to take him wherever he wants to go to. See, so the problem is they don't like us speaking that way because it's, you know, how dare you? Univision is a whole network that's for Latinos.
Yeah.
Whole network. ABC, NBC, CBS, all these networks for years have essentially excluded us. Yeah, we have some shows on there. Yeah, we have some faces on there. But go to the executive ranks in the suites to see who's in charge. And so that's always threatened them because black empowerment has always freaked out white America because they've never wanted us to affirm each other. I would tell people all the time, and Rock, this happened. A brother hit me, man, and he said, man, when are you going to get you a show? I said, well, I'm on every day. He said, no, I mean a real show. Hmm. I said, what's a real show? He said, no, I mean like, you know, CNN and MSNBC.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And this has happened multiple times. This is not one time.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, brother, I said, and this is when Brian Williams was still
TVOne's
the anchor.
Black owned company's ice wasn't cold.
He literally said
water
that.
Wasn't wet enough.
This is when Brian Williams was still anchor of NBC, mm-hmm. Nightly News. I said, brother, do you understand that when Brian Williams comes to DC, he sits in the exact same chair I sit in? I said, do you know there was a table on the left side and the bottom, there's a bristle brush and a mirror. I said, Brian can't use a bristle brush, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't his hair.
Yeah.
I said, do you realize that the cameras and the desk and the walls? I said, here's what you don't realize. We do our show, we shoot our show at NBC News Channel. We contract with them to do our show. Mm-hmm. I said, I sit in on the same set. I said, we send it to Denver the same way they do.
Mm-hmm.
It goes up the satellite the same way they do. I said, but you say the show's not real. Mm-hmm. That's the same thing. And so for white America to be able to have a show where they are not the centerpiece is what's threatening. See, they're not used to that. They're not used to being visitors in a conversation. Mm-hmm. They're not used to there being a dinner party where they are not the center of attention. And so when that woman, when she watches that live stream, when she watches the TV show, she's going, well, what's going on? The focus is not on me.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's not, boo. It's on them. Just like if I'm watching a show, if I'm reading Essence, if I'm reading Cosmopolitan, that ain't for me. They're talking to women. Now, I can read it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I can enjoy it,
mm-hmm.
I can learn from it,
mm-hmm.
but I can't start acting a fool saying, well, why do I see me?
Mm-hmm.
'Cause it's not for you.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, and you shouldn't be threatened.
We have a long history of specialized magazines, specialized television shows,
right.
Specialized radio stations. I like some country music,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but I listen to R&B.
Yeah.
I don't expect to turn to the country station and hear LSG or Frankie Beverly and Maze,
mm-hmm.
or hear Pat LaBelle, because
mm-hmm.
that's not what the station is programmed for. And that's the issue. White America has controlled everything for so long, but the idea that, wait a minute, that's something we don't control that?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
You don't.
I want to go to a clip here of Alfred Liggins, who certainly, when he was here, I asked him, you know, was NewsOne Now, you know, his baby,
mm-hmm.
and how did that come about? Let's take a look at his conversation, and then we'll come back and talk
cool.
about it. NewsOne Now, your baby?
Yes, absolutely.
Why?
Didn't exist on television. There needs to be a voice. We've always fashioned ourselves as not just a media outlet, just to entertain people, but as a communication link, you know, to help motivate, you know, drive and spark debate. You know, I got to tell you, and you know, unfortunately, you know, a lot of people don't talk about it, but you know, I think, you know, you're getting to a time where you can, you know, in the age of the first black president over the last 6 years, there hasn't been an agenda for African Americans, and with the crash, you know, of the economy, we've actually gone backwards.
Yeah.
You know, we've gone backwards politically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in many of the jurisdictions that used to be controlled, you know, by African Americans, we've gone backwards economically. And if you do not have a voice that raises those issues and tries to galvanize, you know, an effort to move forward from an educational, a business, you know, a moral standpoint to raise a community, then the community does it.
In 8 days, that show ends.
It's hard. It's painful. The reaction has been stunning.
Mm-hmm.
The social media reaction, The phone calls, the emails, and people saying, what can we do? How can we save it? What, you know, folks are going, rolling and go online. Let's do a subscription model. I mean, because, and what that speaks to one, the lack of for so many years. Yeah. And then all of a sudden for folks to say, we had it, now it's gone. It literally is the equivalent of if you grew up with a black newspaper.
Yeah.
And that was the source.
Yeah.
The next thing you know,
yeah.
that's it.
Yeah.
You know, this is the 190th anniversary of this year, of the founding of the nation's first black newspaper, mm-hmm. Freedom's Journal, March 1827. And in its lead editorial, John Rossworm, Samuel Cornish were the first editors. The lead editorial said, "We wish to plead our own cause. Too long have others spoken for us." That's what that means. And so where we are is technology is changing. You have to deal with the economic realities. And that's really what Alfred told me why the show's ending. And what we have to then decide is—
Dealing with the economic realities.
The economic realities of, I mean, the reality is we're not a, TVOne is not a cable news network.
Mm-hmm.
It's an entertainment network.
Sure.
So in essence, you have, out of 24 hours in a day, you have 2 hours to a news show.
Mm-hmm.
And so then it becomes, it's also, I mean, unlike other shows, whether you're running sitcoms or whatever, I mean, our stuff is not necessarily evergreen. I mean, mm-hmm. yeah, there's some things we can do
sure.
that you can run multiple times, but it's not deemed in the cable industry an evergreen show. Mm-hmm. If you've got a sitcom, you can run that for 30 years,
mm-hmm.
the same sitcom.
Mm-hmm.
If you've got a movie, you
yeah.
can run that multiple times. Right. The reality is our content changes every day,
mm-hmm.
And so therefore it's costly. And so that's why the decision was made.
Well, let me address something that I've noticed. It would be very hard not to notice it. So obviously, you were popular beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
Since the announcement, the incredible outpouring that I have seen, it seems to have magnified times 10
mm-hmm.
in terms of people's support for you and for your voice and what you've brought to the table the last
right.
the last several years, not just
right.
with TVOne.
I think folks, I think what you're experiencing is you're hearing people say that, I mean, literally a very prominent preacher said to me, Roland, they're not just missing the show. He said, there's only one of you who says what you say and the way you say it.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't even describe for you, I mean, I can't describe what it feels like when you travel this country and you encounter people and they're talking about the show and what it means and how emotional people get.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I was in Atlanta,
yeah.
Switching flights, and I'm waiting at the gate, and a brother walks up to me and he says, "Thank you," and shakes my hand.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm used to that.
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Brother, I appreciate it." He said,
sure.
"No, thank you,"
mm-hmm.
and walks off.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's all he said.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
He doesn't say
yeah.
this show or this
yeah.
segment.
Yeah,
that's all he said.
Yes, yes.
I'm at the MGM. Marlon Wayans was shooting his Netflix comedy.
Mm.
A brother comes up to me and he says, "Man, I got to get a photo."
Mm.
I said, "Okay, no problem." He said, "Dom, I don't think you understand." He said, "I just got out of prison.
Mm-hmm.
I've been in prison 5 years.
Right.
He said, "My cellmate turned me on to your show. Brother, I got through prison every day
mm-hmm.
watching and being educated by you."
So whoever may criticize, whatever experts may criticize, your validation comes.
Oh, thank you. I don't care what any other media person says. Mm-hmm. I don't care what any critic says. I remember when David Zerowick, whatever his name is, with the Baltimore Sun, was trying to rip me for being on CNN. I didn't know what I was talking about. And I said, well, obviously, you haven't read the resume with all the political stuff that I've covered. When, you know, Jake Tapper sends his little tweets, he's all mad and everything. And I tweeted back, I said, you mean nothing to me nor my community. No, that's precisely it. I don't need that. I don't need somebody to say, any kind of media person or whatever, because when you step out there and when, I mean, Stacey Abrams running for governor, and she emails me, she said, Roland, she texts me, she said, can you send this brother an email? I said, well, who is it? She said, he just finished interviewing me. And at the end of it, he said, it was you who has taught him why black politics matter. And that's why he went to meet me.
And that's
what causes you to wake up and say,
which leads me here, before we come back, because I sure want to come back and talk about what's going to be next for Roland Martin. But before we get there, that's a good segue. The state of black media overall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, man, there was a certain consistency and a certain joy in that consistency of being able to get Jet Magazine.
Yeah.
And in the barbershop, you know what they said. It ain't happened yet.
Right.
If it ain't in Jet.
Right.
And we have so little of that.
Yep.
NewsOne Now.
Same thing.
Was that.
Right.
And you now NewsOne Now is going to be no more.
I mean, like, you knew after last night, oh, we gonna find out the real black. Okay, CNN, MSNBC, y'all can credit the educated suburban. No, we gonna get the real deal. Mm-hmm. And you're right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's so sad about it. And look, I ran the Chicago Defender when it was 4 days a week.
Yeah.
The economics changed, and we had to turn it into a twice a week paper.
Yeah.
Now it's a weekly.
Yeah. Do you understand that?
I was running it.
Yeah.
So now all of a sudden, people then begin to say, okay, Roland, but what does that mean? Well, first, what it means is we have to use our collective power to make it clear to major advertisers that this is who we trust, so therefore you have to fund it. 63% of all digital ad dollars go to Facebook and Google. That means everybody else online is sharing 37%. Everybody else. Well, here's the problem. Facebook and Google don't have the quality content unless it's produced by somebody else. For African Americans, it's who do we trust? Black folk, I mean, and I've heard this when I was on CNN. And first of all, let me remind people, I was on TVOne before CNN.
Mm-hmm.
Jonathan Rogers said, your voice matters. I got paid by TVOne before CNN, which is why I never left.
Mm-hmm.
CNN wanted me to leave. I said no.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted me to leave my Tom Jones segment. I said no.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted me to stop doing my own radio show. I said no. They wanted me to stop doing my speeches and do my books. I said no. There's a reason, because I was not going to let one entity control all my money.
Yeah.
It was me to control my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
But so what has to happen is, black folks have to make a conscious decision right now, and that is, are we going to are we only going to speak up about what is ours when it's gone, or when it's potentially about to leave, or are we making conscious decisions? Are we making conscious decisions to subscribe to black magazines? Are we making conscious decisions to say, if I'm gonna put my money where my mouth is?
Mm-hmm.
And so folks keep asking, you know, what's next? There are a number of things. I'm still under contract through August 31st, 2018 with TVOne. So we're talking about what's next. I was already doing my own podcast. I still do my own book. I still speak. But I'm looking at other things. I am a techie. I'm very much a tech person. You talk about live streaming, all those different things. You got those options, whether you're talking about Twitter or Facebook or YouTube, or whether you're talking about a streaming service, whether you're talking about its Tidal or Quayle TV or Urban Movie Channel or whether it's Netflix or Amazon, whatever, because consumers are getting their stuff different ways. What's very interesting is I have a huge millennial foundation who doesn't even see me on TVOne. Mm-hmm. They see my stuff mm-hmm. on Facebook mm-hmm. and YouTube. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so the question now becomes, how do you reach your largest audience? And so there are different models. You got not for-profit models, you got non-profit models. The Daily Caller, conservative website, the Texas Tribune, they're non-profit entities. The Marshall Project, ProPublica. So these are people who are doing great journalism that are going through a non-profit vehicle. So there are multiple ways, and so I'm looking at different ways. I still believe that a daily news show targeting African Americans can work. The key is, what's the economic model to ensure it succeeds? And so we're looking at that, studying that, and then also while we make a decision, what happens with TVOne and what am I going to be doing, you know, what is it, you know, whatever. But all of those things are there because the people clearly are saying, we want this, we need this, especially going to a midterm election, mm-hmm. especially 2 years out, 3 years out from the 2020 election. And so it's just a matter of what works and what makes sense economically. And I believe it can work. I believe that model exists. It's just a matter of finding the right pieces.
You have been unapologetic in your support of women's issues, women's rights. You keep hearing the term today of that there is now a tipping point. In terms of the issue of a sexual abuse, sexual harassment, Congress people are dropping, folks are dropping. There's been the call for the president to resign. the leader of the free world, call on him to resign. That movement seems to be gaining momentum.
Oh, yeah.
Again, part of the response from last night's election in Alabama had to do with that particular movement.
Oh, yeah.
So when you hear the phrase tipping point, what does that mean to you? And I'd just like to get your feedback on what's happening.
Well, I think first, I mean, it's basic. And that is, woman wants to come to work and just do the work. I mean, it's amazing to me when I read some of these stories, when I read about Matt Lauer and Charlie Rose, and a woman wants to be able to come and do the work. Can I just do the work? Now, it's different if you say, we in the office and we joking with each other and I'm cracking on your clothes and you cracking on. I mean, NewsOne Now, we used to after the show, we all be sitting in the office and we all just be just going, just having fun with each other where they sitting there, Roland, why you got starter tennis shoes on? Mm-hmm. You should be wearing some Nike. And so we had Cherie was one of our, she was love for some Nike. I'm like, girl, I ain't spend no $200 for no tennis shoes. Mm-hmm. These were $25, and guess what? Yeah. They work. Mm-hmm. So we would sit here, and man, we would joke about clothes, and we'd joke about your hair and your hairline, and we just all together. It was men and women, just all kind of fun. But I can't imagine sitting here in an office, and you are sexually charging somebody up. And so what women are saying is, I just want to come to work. It's all I want to do, and I'm just there for the work. I mean, I'll tell you, when I was working in Dallas, I had someone who was an assistant who, gorgeous sister, and we all know dynamics in terms of what folks wear and you know, breasts being pressed in my face. And I said, look, let me explain something to you. I ain't trying to sleep with you. Now, I don't know where else you work. Now, look, of course, an HR person watching, like, Roland, what did you? Yeah, look, I was like 28, 29, running the newspaper. I said, look, I ain't trying to sleep with you. I need you to open a doggone mail, check my faxes. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. So I ain't here for all that. Yeah. I'm married. I'm good. Mm-hmm. Can we focus on? Mm-hmm. And I was just straight up. Mm-hmm. And so a woman just wants to come to work to work. Now, when you see this craziness out here, these folks who are getting busted should get busted.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to deal with that. I don't, like for instance, I don't understand the catcalling deal. It's like, look, if I see a good-looking woman, that's a good-looking woman. The idea of, hey, chasing somebody down when you saw the parade in New York where a sister was shot and killed because she rejected a dude, and then he just unloads on her. I mean, so the average man does not even remotely understand the assault that women go through daily. When I say assault, I'm not saying physical assault. I'm saying what is sexual assault, but that's also mental. Mm-hmm. And it could be physical, mm-hmm. where my advancement is tied to what I do in the bedroom. I mean, it goes on and on and on.
Yeah.
And so what is happening, a cleansing is taking place. Mm-hmm. That, and think about this. We're talking about all this stuff happening a couple of years after one of the most popular television shows ended, Mad Men, that was all about male sexual domination mm-hmm. and female subjugation in the workplace. Mm-hmm. That was one of the most popular shows in television.
And we're talking about this less than a year after the Hollywood Access tape.
Yes.
Revealed what the current president
yes.
is saying, but yet he still became the president.
Well, because everybody forget on the same day that Access Hollywood stuff dropped, as when WikiLeaks dropped the Russian emails.
Ooh, is that a whole nother show.
And those things, yeah. Trust me, go together, but you're absolutely right. The backlash, Trump can absolutely take credit for what's going on right now. Because what essentially folks are saying is, oh, hold up. You did all this stuff for years, and then you became president? No. It's time for, it's mm-hmm. some folks coming down. And see, the thing now is, everybody's focusing on the shiny object, the Charlie Rose, the Matt Lauer, the person who's in the front. But now you got to start dealing with, well, how about the executives who had to know, but who kept promoting?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Mark Halperin, he kept getting promoted. Mm-hmm. He gets $1 million show, mm-hmm. all sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. I cannot even remotely imagine being a black man, and I did some of the stuff. Well, you know what? Here's why I can't imagine that. Because if you look at most of these major media jobs, they not black.
Yeah.
So I can't imagine being in Matt Lauer's position to do that, because I can't imagine being in Matt Lauer's position. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine being in Charlie Rose's position to do what he did, because I won't be in Charlie Rose's position. Mm-hmm. Because doing what I do, that's very threatening to mm-hmm. a lot of white media executives. Mm-hmm. But the moment that we are in is a moment of clarity for not just any man in business right now, but any young man who's in college, and any young man who's in high school, and now any young man who is in elementary school, to understand that what your daddy did, what your uncle did, what your friends did, will not wash. So just like for us, we, even though we have not fully gone through it, we had to deal with this change as a result of racial discrimination. Even though it still exists, we can't ignore that. Mm-hmm. You are now seeing what was fully accepted and passed on from one man to another. Mm-hmm. It's gonna have to stop, but the cleansing has to continue. I do believe though, and this is critically important, I do believe in due process. I do believe in proper investigations. I don't believe in just firing somebody solely off of
sure.
an allegation. Mm-hmm. But for the men who have done stuff and shaken in their boots And just, I'm talking about the stuff, in some of the stuff you hear in the workplace, which is just stunning. I mean, literally, Rock, I see some of these stories and I go,
what the hell?
Look,
and talking about stunning, I can't do this show, which is just simply two days after, again, the man down at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue tweets out about Kirsten Gillibrand, the junior senator from New York, saying that she came to his office, that she would come and beg for donations, and he includes in his tweet, and she would do anything to get them. Now, those who are off in fantasy land that try to pretend that that's not something sexual, and as the USA Today editorial today says,
lit him up.
Donald Trump does not have the decency where he should be allowed to clean Barack Obama's presidential library's toilet.
Or shine George W. Bush's shoes.
Or shine his shoes. That he would have the gall to put that out in the public atmosphere.
Right.
And what is it? I would just want to get your reaction to that.
Oh, no. First of all, the White House then goes, well, if you found that to be sexually suggestive,
yeah,
your mind's in the gutter.
His mind
is always in the gutter. I mean, we're in the business of words. I know how to say something without saying something to say something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We all know what that was.
Yeah.
And that's the deal. Just like when he made the comment about Megyn Kelly, that was just blood coming from out of everywhere.
Right.
We know what he was saying. We all know that. And so they're playing the game. But this is just the reality. And I love all these media people, and they go, oh my God, it's a new low. No, it's not. That's why I use the hashtag, we tried to tell you. We tried to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
We saw it. Y'all didn't believe it. All these media people, well, maybe if he becomes president, he'll start acting presidential. Ain't no 70-year-old man all of a sudden gonna change because he's president. He was uncouth before the election. He was foul and despicable and shameless before the election. And there's nothing that he has proven. I love how, oh, well, he gave a good speech. Maybe he's turned the corner. No, and then next day he tweets up. No, he hasn't. Mm. He is who he is. Accept that reality and go from there.
You know, Roland, while we're paying attention to all of that very base kind of behavior, and it is getting all kinds of media attention, there is a effort that seems to me to be not only underfoot, but turning into reality about the appointment of federal judges.
Oh, yeah.
That is something that I think we should be aware of, be alarmed about. And, you know, I would ask you as a political expert, you know, what, if anything, do you suggest those who might be listening now and hear your voice to do to try to resist that?
First thing, in any endeavor, and you know this being in the boxing business, you don't go into a fight unless you study your opponent. You just don't just jump into a ring and, no, you study your opponent. You study their tendencies, their strengths and weaknesses. You study the percentage of how many times they box southpaw versus being a right. And you look at their feet position. You look at their balance. You look at all that because you're trying to find an edge. You first have to go, Republicans are not talking about principle or character. They focus on winning and power. That's all that matters. Why are white conservative evangelicals in love with Trump? They know he's not a Christian. They know he doesn't espouse Christian values. They only care about one thing. They want right-wing judges that will outlaw same-sex marriage and outlaw abortion. That's it. They want religious freedom. They want to get rid of abortion, to get rid of same-sex marriage. Those are the top three things they want, period. Trump is the conduit for that. Mm-hmm. Republicans don't care. That's why Senator Charles Grassley rushing these people through. The whole blue slip procedure in the Senate, where a senator could hold up a nomination from their home state. Grassley tears up, don't matter, pass them through. Because they're going, we don't know how long this man's gonna be here. We don't know how long we're gonna be in control of the United States Senate. We could lose the Senate in 2018. We wanna rush through as many judges as possible. Republicans have always used the federal bench as a tool to drive votes. But I need people to understand why. To understand why they are so adamant about that, it's because white Americans have been angry at the federal courts since 1954, Brown versus Board of Education. They were angry with the Sweat decision. They were angry with all of, with of course, Civil Rights Act, Voting Rights Act, Fair Housing Act, angry. They were angry that the federal courts were used. They were angry about busing. They were so their anger, because so when you hear an activist judge, they're not talking about a conservative judge. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They're only talking about what they consider to be liberal or progressive judges. So they value the Supreme Court and the federal bench, and it's a top priority when they're voting. I think for a lot of progressives, I think for African Americans, and there are other issues important. No. What we have to do is we have to begin to teach people what that judge does. So for instance, we get excited and focused on the mayor and the governor's race and member of Congress race and the US Senate race. But then you go down ballot. See, now in the last 5 years, we now understand the importance of who that DA is. So now you got the sister in Cook County, Chicago, and you got, they threw out Tim McGinty in Cuyahoga County in Cleveland. You got Aramis Ayala in Florida. You had Craig Watkins in Dallas. You got Marilyn Mosby in Baltimore. You had Ken Thompson who died in Brooklyn. You know, all these, now people go, oh, now we see that the person who charges the cops, the person who filed, now we see, now those races matter. So now people are mobilizing around that. Well, same thing with the judicial races. Well, your kid are most impacted by whoever's that particular judge, your district court judge in your city, in your state. So now take it national. If you now have a flood of right-wing judges, they'll ignore, they'll throw out, no class action lawsuit. I'm not gonna stay the execution of somebody who might be on death row. Mm-hmm. Those matter. And so moving forward, we have to make the judicial process just as critical as a priority mm-hmm. as the right wing, because they understand you put a 35-year-old judge indeed. On the bench yeah. for a lifetime appointment, mm-hmm. they will be making decisions literally that will outlast 5, 6, 7 U.S. presidents.
Yeah. Do you have any political aspirations?
Nope. I've had people, when I was in Fort Worth, my second job out of college, it was funny, we had a gridiron club event, raised money, journalists did skits and stuff. And Larry Shannon, he was a chief of staff to former Speaker of the House, Jim Wright. Mm. He came up to me and he said, Roland, I've observed you for the last 2 weeks. And he said, I've only seen two other politicians in my history who can work a room better than you. He said, you don't have to worry about the office or the money. We'll raise the money, we'll pick the office. All you gotta do is say yes to running. I said, Larry, appreciate that. No. Dallas, Houston, Chicago, they want me to run. No, God, I went to a communications high school. Mm-hmm. I'm doing since I was 14 years old.
We've got 1 minute.
I am doing exactly what God designed for me to do. Mm-hmm. God, even people say, Roland, you should be preaching. No, my wife was ordained. God said, Roland, you can speak to more people on radio and television in 1 hour than some preachers would preach to in a decade. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. This is where I'm best. Unless God tells me to run, no. He said, you're doing what you're designed to do, and that's media.
My brother, it sounds as if you have absolutely listened. I want to encourage you to keep doing what
Appreciate
you
it.
Do, man. Thank you so much for coming.
Hashtag bring the funk, baby.
Hashtag bring the funk. Thank you.
Appreciate
Folks,
it.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.